human rights advocacy. And it's my great pleasure to welcome all of you this afternoon, students, colleagues, members of the community, guests. Last night we heard from Franz de Waal in the first keynote address on the question, destined to wage war forever, peacemaking among primates. He explained the difficulties involved in conducting experiments, intergroup relationships, because in many cases, of course, when you put groups together, either within species or between species, the result is violence. I'm very happy to say that here at the University of Utah, we are putting lots of different groups together, academics from different disciplines, locals and guests from afar, and members of the community and scholars, and so far, so good. No violence, no resort to violence. So. A little bit about the conference format. For those of you who haven't yet attended another session, most of our sessions take place just down the road in the Officers Club here at Fort Douglas. The one other exception is that tonight there'll be a poster session at the Alta Club downtown on South Temple. So we invite all of you to attend as much of the events of these 2 days as possible. And a reminder that everything is free and open to the public, and you are all welcome to chime in the lively discussions that are already taking place. I'd like to introduce John Seeger, who will introduce our two keynote speakers this afternoon. John is a professor of biology here at the U, where he specializes in evolutionary biology and population genetics. He has done research on various problems in behavioral ecology, including sexual selection, sex ratio strategies, and the evolution of sex itself. Recently, succumb to the temptation to make a joke there, okay? Recently, he's been working on the evolutionary genetics of whale lice, which provides a uniquely well-defined natural experiment in, quote, nothing much happens for millions of years, so then what? John will now introduce our keynote speakers for this afternoon. Thank you.
Well, can you hear me? Is this on? It's a huge honor for me, bigger than you can imagine, to introduce Margot Wilson and Martin Daly. They have been special intellectual and personal heroes of mine for quite a long time. As I recall, I was still a graduate student when I first met them and was struck at once how wickedly but sensibly smart they seemed, how shrewd at picking important but solvable problems, and how open-minded but remorselessly logical. And really fun to be around, not to mention awfully nice. So I looked forward to seeing them always or reading anything that they had written, but I never stopped to ask what was the source of these delightful and, to an academic, certainly extremely admirable qualities. What does a person have to do to be like that? Good question, and I don't claim to know the answer, but two recent events have at least suggested a clue to me. The first of these was John Updike's passing, and the second, Darwin's endless birthday party, which we're now blessedly coming to the end of. Updike is supposed to have said that you can choose to see or to be seen, but not both, by which I take him to mean that a certain kind of self-effacement is required if what you most want to do is give reality a fair chance to surprise you with something new. That's the stance of an ecologist, for whom all the properties of organisms, including their behavior, of course, make sense only in the context of their environment, in all of its messy complexity and its history, which must therefore be taken into account. Darwin was, unlike most subsequent evolutionists, in being, first and foremost, an ecologist. His temperament was probably much like Updike's, and this month I've come to the view, which I'm certain is not the least bit original, but new to me, that this was one of the keys to, an essential key to his brilliance. I think the same goes for Daly and Wilson. All four of them agree that theories are important and conceptual coherence is essential, but that's the destination, not the starting point. God really is in the empirical details, and you had better start by learning them well with as few preconceptions as possible. Most of you probably know Martin and Margot as pioneering evolutionary psychologists who have bravely and incisively explored the natural histories of child abuse, murder, and also a few lighter sides of the human condition. But you may not know that for years they have also tried to understand how kangaroo rats think about foraging. Please note the parallel to Darwin, who worked on barnacles, to the point that he remains a leading authority on some aspects of their biology. So my new theory of Martin and Margot is that of all of Darwin's thousands of intellectual descendants, they may actually be among those that best resemble the old guy in this important matter of attitude and method. Whether I'm right or wrong about this, I don't care. I'm just happy they've come here today to ask, in our hearing, nothing to lose, economic inequality, poor life prospects, and lethal competition. Please join me in welcoming Margot and Martin.
Thank you, John. That's a tough act to follow. Thanks to all the organizers and the people responsible for bringing us here and making this event so enjoyable. Yeah, this is our title. We'll give you a quick roadmap of what we intend to do, partly in case we don't get through all of it. I first wanted to tell you that killers and their victims are mostly young men, with a little bit of data. Tell you why we think of homicide as a reflection of competition. Men kill one another in competitive conflicts. And then we will present some data showing that rates of homicide are especially high among men who have little to lose.
Then we'll talk about how homicide rates are so variable and some of the reasons why they might be. We'll discuss circumstances, where people live, where winners take all, and where the future is uncertain.
Then, if there's time, I'm going to say a few words about, well, this is obviously a false opposition. Is the reason why homicide rates have been high in the U.S. South a matter of a culture of violence, or is there an economic explanation? There's obviously some truth to both, but bear with us, and you'll see why I'm opposing these things. And finally, again, if we don't blather on too slowly, we'll talk about why homicide rates have fallen in recent years despite rising inequality, having told you earlier in the talk that inequality is a great predictor of homicide rates. First point we want to make is that homicide is largely a male affair. These are Canadian data, age-specific rates at which men killed unrelated men versus women killed unrelated women, and women don't go tending to kill their rivals nearly so often as men. These happen to be Canadian data. Later in the talk, you'll see some U.S. data that will look uncannily similar. In North America, over 90% of killers are men. That's probably well known. Perhaps less well known is that the great majority of victims are men, too. The same is true almost everywhere in the world. The exceptions are found places where rates are extremely low. And then these male-male cases are the cases that have dropped out. And what remains, perhaps, is some trickle of spousal homicides and neonaticides and so on. But wherever the homicide rates are high, the great majority of victims and offenders are men. Killers usually know their victims personally, although the definitional distinction between strangers and acquaintances can be sort of how long have they been in the same bar. They're very rarely relatives. And our focus is going to be on men killing men to whom they are not related by either blood or marriage, or at least not to a degree of which close enough for anybody to detect, because first of all, that's the majority of all homicides, and it's the most variable component of the homicide rate. And if you want to understand why homicide rates vary, you want to understand why these kinds of cases vary in particular. So why do men kill one another? Well, Margot and I have spent a fair bit of time reading police investigative files in Detroit and in Chicago, reading anthropological material on this. And I think this is a fair summary statement, illustrated by this nice woodcut by a contemporary Brazilian artist. Acquaintance cases and stranger cases tend to be similar, and the primary context is some sort of social competition between the two. And by social competition, I mean there's not an immediate, obvious, material issue at hand. There's a status challenge, there's rival over a woman, there's some sort of disrespect in front of an audience that elicits some sort of escalated competition that ends in lethality. In the U.S. in recent decades, something slightly over 50% of all homicides have been of this sort. The next most common context, and the majority of the remainder, is straightforward material competition. I say robbery or business rivalry, of course, usually illegal, but not necessarily illegal business. So you can think of both of these contexts as competitive. In the one case, people are competing over what they perceive to be limited social resources of status and position. In other cases, it's more straightforward what they're competing over. You know, you've got some money I want, I kill you, now it's mine. Men are poorer than women. Why do men compete with each other more often than women? And here is our evolution-minded gloss on this, the one slide in which we'll sort of fire through a bit of contemporary, conventional wisdom among evolution-minded students of behavior, both human and non-human, and to give a flavor for what we think is going on. Darwinian selection is largely a matter of differential reproduction among same-sex competitors. You know, you could say one way to think about selection is within populations, males are engaged in a sort of zero-sum contest for the paternity of future generations, and females are engaged in a parallel contest over maternity, which is not to say that males and females are never in competition for something they both want, but you understand in the sexually reproducing species why we might say this. And in the human animal, as in many others, we have lots of reasons to believe that fitness is more variable among males, that fitness has long been more variable among human males and more rank dependent, perhaps something that is less cross-species general. Successful men often have higher fitness than any one woman because of the possibility of polygyny, but men are also more likely to die without reproducing, and there's lots of evidence that this is so in contemporary small-scale societies, and lots of reason to believe that's been true for much of human evolution. So the prizes for winning in competition and the penalties for losing have been bigger for men than they have been for women. And we would suggest that for this reason, men have evolved to be more motivated to compete with one another than women and to be less deterred by danger from engaging in such competition. Margot?
Okay, so I'm a woman, and maybe I'm a sort of a weak-minded woman at that. And so these sort of lethal social competitions that precede the final outcome of the homicide are not intuitive to me. I don't understand them. But men engage in them a lot, and in some kinds of superficial examination of it, you might think it's over trivial matters, but it's obviously very important to them. And so we have to... I have to give them the benefit of the doubt that it's a serious matter. And I can tell you right now that we need to understand the circumstances and the mind frame of the men when they're engaged in these situations that might end up in a lethal outcome, because they are not suicidal. They are not engaged in what we might think superficially as dysfunctional behavior, and so we need to understand what the social dynamics are. And so thinking about that in a very general sense, we've tried to think about what's fundamental to a lot of the circumstances of the men who might get engaged in a risky confrontation where they there might be a competitive benefit in the final outcome if they don't die. Okay, so Bob Dylan said a theme that we're going to bring home today is that when you got nothing to lose. And that was very eloquent. And so we're going to show you data about being unemployed as a risk factor. And for the evolution-minded people who have studied a lot of other species, resource circumstances certainly gain you access to females. And another kind of situation where you got nothing to lose is that when you're being unmarried. And we can understand a lot of competition amongst men in general and in lethal competition as directly or indirectly about competition for access to mates. And so with that sort of our thinking about the following analyses. So this is a data slide from a long time ago. And in green are the unemployed men, and the employed men are in the darker charcoal and the age of the men. These are only killers, and victims would look very much the same. And we have on the Y slides homicides per million per annum. And so you can see at all ages except for the teenagers that unemployment is a significant risk factor for killing somebody. And in fact, the teenagers, that their unemployed circumstances, they're mostly students. So it's very different kind of circumstance than unemployment when you're older. And in Detroit at this time frame, unemployment now was probably predictive of unemployment in the future, that their life prospects, their economic prospects were very poor. And so you might have thought this is obvious. You read the newspaper, you understand about the role of poverty and unemployment and the risk of violence. And but in 1985, when we published this, this was the first empirical demonstration that employment really made a difference. And you'll see the same theme that Martin introduced in the first age, age-related homicide rates, that we still get an age effect. So you have an age effect within the unemployed and within the employed, but still employment status is very important. Now, in Detroit at that time, we are also able to test marital status, and the graph looks very similar to this, that the unmarried men were equivalent to the green bars, and the married men's rates were equivalent to the charcoal. But we actually have better data from Canada in some senses, even though the homicide rates are much lower. So here we're showing you the rates of homicide over this time period for single men versus married men. And at all these age categories, that the rates are substantially higher for single men. And you might think, okay, well, this is just a reflexive bias. There's nothing pacifying, if you like, about being married. And because maybe the women won't marry the kind of guy that gets into these kind of homicidal situations. And so that's why those guys are single. However, when they're divorced, the married guys jump up to the same kinds of rates as the single men. They seem to go into single mode. But then again, you can also say another kind of bias, that the women dump those guys who are violent, and that's why we've got the divorce rate going up again. It's a particular kind of character. But then what about when they're widowed? Okay, so widowhood is bad too. And I can tell you right now that these men are not widowers because they killed their wife. And also, you don't need to worry about 15 to 29 year old widowers. That they're extremely lethal and dangerous out there, because there's so few cases of these that these estimates are fairly unreliable, and the variance around the estimates is high, but I think the relative standing is good. So here I've shown you sort of two circumstances of men that elevate the risk of killing somebody, of being involved in homicide, and of killing another man. And I've shown it to you for within Canada and within Detroit. And so what about, since most of us know that, or at least we hear most about the variations in homicide rates amongst places being so highly variable, that that we want to pay attention to that, and I want to remind you about just how hugely variable they are. So these are old data, but in fact I recently looked up the recent data, and the numbers aren't very much different, although the rates are a little tiny bit different in almost every one of these countries. Iceland, they only had homicide rates of about 4 persons were killed per million persons in the population. And this is true Canada, we're sort of in the middle of most things. And but the U.S., in terms of first world countries, have very high rates, have had at that time and still have, even though the rates have gone down. But if you compare with other countries, that the U.S. still looks pretty good. I mean, Russia was terrible at this time. Mexico was terrible, and so was Brazil, and Brazil still is. China wasn't bad then. I don't predict good things for China in the future, but that's another issue, and we wait to see what happens and hope they'll be okay. So I've reminded you that Rates are highly variable, and we're going to talk about trying to account for some of the variation. But first, I want to remind you that there are, even though the rates vary tremendously, look at the y-axis for these different figures. For Canada, you've already seen it, and so England and Wales here. Here's the rate. Here's the rate. So England is far more Pacific than we are. And this is the age of the killer. These are men. These are women. And in Chicago, the rates are hugely different, but we still get the same kind of pattern. We get the same kind of robust sex difference. And in fact, if you plotted the just the women on this English graph, it would look like the guys just about. And but that's not the kind of question we're trying to pursue. We're trying to understand variation between places and according to the different circumstances of people within those places. And that's a topic to Martin's going to continue with now.
Yeah, I want to tell you about what predicts, what possibly accounts for this kind of astonishing cross-national variability in homicide rates. And as many of you may know, there have been many attempts to study this with cross-national studies. Often, the predictor variables are differently measured in different countries and so on, so that there's, you know, some controversy. But I think it's safe to say that the consensus opinion among criminologists who've addressed this question of international variability in homicide rates, and indeed in other violent crime, is that the single most best predictor, a most robustly recurrent predictor in different kinds of analyses, is inequitable distribution of income, income inequality, rather than income distributed, or rather than average level of income, rather than GDP per capita or something like that. I'll quickly show you how people measure income inequality, because we're going to use this Gini coefficient. Gini, by the way, it's not an acronym. Gini was an Italian economist. And I guess he invented this coefficient. If you line up all your units, be they typically households rather than individuals, but be they households or individuals or whatever, if you order them along the x-axis at equal intervals from the poorest to the wealthiest, and then plot the cumulative income. If everybody had identical income, you would get a curve like this. You would get the same rise for each, you know, individual you incremented along here. If you had the circumstance where Warren Buffett owns everything and everybody else owns nothing, then, you know, you would go along very close to here and then you'd jump up there at the end. But of course, real income distribution curves always look intermediate. The Lorentz curve, named after another economist, not after Comrade Lorentz. So the way we define the Gini coefficient is simply as this area divided by the sum of these two areas. And obviously, as income becomes more equitable, this goes to zero. As income becomes more inequitable, it goes towards one. That's the Gini coefficient. I mentioned that it's a very good predictor on cross-national data. It's hard to give you a good portrayal of that because of messy, inconsistent ways of measuring certain things. But it's also a very good predictor on much more local levels. Homicide rates in the 50 states of the USA, for example, are remarkably well predicted by income inequality, Gini coefficient. Here are data that we published based on 1990 US data. Utah, by the way, is that point right there. So Utah is a nice Pacific, relatively equitable sort of place compared to most states of the Union. Most of the other low homicide, low inequality states are actually in New England. But you can see here that income inequality accounts for about half of the variance in homicide rates between states. And it's also perhaps striking to note just how variable homicide rates are between states. We're not talking about 10%, 20%, 30% differences. We're talking about tenfold differences between the best places and the worst places. Median household income does nothing as a predictor. It's the distribution of income that is a predictor. It's not like the poor states have high homicide rates and the rich states have low homicide rates. That's not going to explain things. And we in Canada have exercised ourselves for decades, maybe centuries, about why are the Americans so weird and dangerous down there south of the border? It's their gun culture. It's their, you know, we had the Royal Canadian Mounted Police out west before the big wave of immigration, and the Americans didn't have anything corresponding, so they had self-help, justice, and blah, blah, blah. And there may be truth to all of these things. But if you just plot Canadian and U.S. homicide rates by the 50 U.S. states and the 10 Canadian provinces as a function of income inequality in those places, they come pretty close to lying on the same regression. The worst Canadian provinces are kind of like the best U.S. states in terms of low homicide rates and relatively equitable income distribution. And this variable looks like it's pretty important. Margot.
So you get this kind of pattern even on a much finer spatial scale than across states or provinces. So we did this for Chicago, where we were studying homicide. Chicago is good for studying homicide compared to Canada, because they have lots of data from a certain perspective. And the Gini coefficient is very high, and from here, it goes from 0.3 to 0.6. And that last slide you saw, the Gini coefficient was just hovering around 0.50 for the worst state in the union. And but in certain neighborhoods in Chicago, it's far more inequitable. And so that this is played out in terms of the homicide outcomes that occur. So this is a very, very strong correlate, even within jurisdictions. Might work for New York City, for other places, if you could get local data. Oh, we don't want this guy. He's ever so helpful. Okay. So, but this isn't the most powerful predictor of homicide rates in the city of Chicago. In the 77 neighborhoods, we computed life expectancy at birth for males. And the direction, of course, will be different. So here we have male life expectancy at birth, which is just below 55 years in the worst, the shortest life expectancy neighborhoods, and well over 75 in the best neighborhoods. And then these are the homicide rates per million persons in the neighborhoods, just like you saw before. We computed life expectancy with homicide as a cause of death taken out, so there's no circularity. And this, as far as I know, is still the highest correlation coefficient for accounting for homicide rates variations according to jurisdiction anywhere in the criminological literature. And we became, of course, quite interested in what is going on in people's minds when they live in neighborhoods with short life expectancy versus longer. And that's sort of an ongoing topic, but not today's. Okay, so I want to sum up before we carry on about what we've shown you. In general, we've thought of lethal competition that is exacerbated when competitors have little to lose, when the life of your future is uncertain, and winners take all. And so these are, you know, big themes that have affected our thinking about how we get variation in homicide rates and the psychology of men, so that in whatever areas they live and whatever circumstances they are, they will be sensitive to cues of these factors. So Martin's going to continue with talking about the culture of violence.
Yes, I want to return to the idea that there are cultural supports for high levels of violence, and particularly perhaps in the United States. I mean, homicide rates are consistently higher in the U.S. than in other developed countries. We showed you data for Chicago before. There aren't really good national level data, unfortunately. We have a problem in the U.S. of, you know, some states sometimes refusing to report their data to the FBI and things like that. Here, California is a good comparison to Canada, about the same population, higher average income, very much higher homicide rates nevertheless. The U.S., is, you know, notorious in the developed world for having a remarkably high homicide rate. And a very popular theory, as I alluded to before, blames American culture for legitimizing and perhaps even in some sense glorifying violence. And certainly this is a widely adhered to view. Whoops, I meant to animate that bottom thing. But many policymakers obviously accept this. An excerpt from a speech by Janet Reno, you may remember the Attorney General under the Clinton administration, speaking to the American Bar Association in 1998, she said she drew a contrast between Toronto and Chicago, two cities at the same latitude and of roughly the same size, and made this comparison. In the 5 years from 1992 through 1996, she's speaking in 98, Toronto experienced exactly 100 gun homicides, while Chicago, an American city of comparable size, had 3,000 and something. And then the punchline was, if we work really hard at it, we could end the culture of violence in this nation, by which she meant the U.S., even though she was actually speaking in Toronto. Media commentators obviously take seriously this idea that the U.S. is violent because of its culture, too. And this is just one example. You know, a review of the movie Bowling for Columbine, Michael Moore clearly demonstrates how a culture of fear leads to a culture of violence. But the question one might ask after looking at the income inequality data I showed you is, do we really need to invoke a culture of violence to explain high violence in the US, or just a culture that somehow institutionalizes and legitimizes inequality? And it's a complicated issue, which I'm going to simplify. But in particular, people have addressed the issue of culture of violence by comparing the U.S. North and the U.S. South. And the advocates of the idea of a culture of violence in the U.S. South, who I think have done the most elegant and impressive job making a case for the South being different because it is culturally different, are Dick Nisbet and Dov Cohen, a couple of psychologists who've done a variety of kinds of studies. But they've documented differences between the U.S. North and South in gross homicide rates. But they've also pointed out that this is specifically in the context of macho confrontations. And in this case, they've confined attention to white men because they want to eliminate all the sort of the possible relevance and confounding of the history of slavery and racial politics and so on. And they make the point, illustrated in this slide, that homicide rates are higher in the South than in the North, both in small cities and in larger cities, and that this is true specifically for argument-related murders, but not or not necessarily for so-called felony-related murders. If you take, you're taking gross FBI data, and there's some codes of the type of conflict, and so felony-related murder will be like incidental to a robbery. You don't get the regional differences. Where you get the regional differences is macho confrontations between guys. And again, we're just talking about white men here. And I don't know how many of you have read Nisbet and Cohen's book, The Culture of Honor. It's a wonderful book. It's a really nice piece of social science in the way it brings together all different kinds of information. They make the point that from various kinds of evidence, much of it collected by themselves, that besides killing at higher rates than Northerners, Southerners do all these other things. They oppose gun control more. They favor the death penalty more. They're more sympathetic to those who are provoked into violence. They don't think someone should go to jail for killing someone who insulted them, et cetera. One of the most interesting things is an experimental result of Cohen and Nisbet's, where they showed that University of Michigan students who have been raised in the South versus the North, the Southern men exhibit a big testosterone surge in response to an insult that has no effect on the men from the North. So there's cultural differences, all right. And their conclusion, their inference, their interpretation is that Southerners possess and transmit over generations and to one another attitudes and values that legitimate and encourage violence, especially violence in defense of personal and family honor. Sorry for the Canadian spelling there. But in making this argument, I think they overstate this conclusion. Nisbet and Cohen argue this explanation is strictly historical, and then they have an historical rationale for its origin, which is too much of a tangent to go into today, but that there's no current economic rationale for these North-South differences. Well, is that so? Variability in homicide rates among U.S. states is certainly unrelated to income. As I showed you before, now I've divided the states up into the blue and the gray, the north and the south. And you can see that homicide rates are higher in the south, and sure doesn't look like income is accounting for the difference. But the same variability is strongly related to income inequality. And when you look at these data, you think, gee, income inequality is accounting for a lot of the north-south difference. Now, I presented this at a small meeting a while back where Dick Nisbet was present, and he immediately objected. Quite reasonably, he said, you got to restrict the analysis to white men. He says, and it's true, one of the strengths of their analysis, in a way, is you get rid of all the sort of complicated history of racial inequality in the U.S. by keeping their analysis confined to white men. And he said, when you do this analysis for white men, you won't get the same results. Well, with the help of an economist, Angus Deaton, I got a hold of income distribution data for white men as distinct from other people and was able to do this kind of analysis. White men's income indeed does not predict their homicide rates across U.S. states, but income inequality, white men's income inequality, does. And the Southern effect almost, not quite, almost disappears when you do this analysis. The point I want to make is a small one in a way. I mean, Nisbet and Cullen are undoubtedly correct that there are attitudinal and value differences, cultural differences between North and South that legitimate violence in one place more than another and so on. But the suggestion that they have made, and several other people have made, that these cultural effects have an inertia that will be very difficult to change by policy changes because of the self-replicating power of culture, I think may be too hasty a conclusion. When you introduce income leveling practices, homicide rates can change. When you do other things, homicide rates can change. Violence rates can change fast. They skyrocketed in Russia after the fall of the Soviet Union. They have fallen rapidly in other places. I mean, Margot showed you Iceland has the lowest homicide rate in the developed world nowadays. Once upon a time, a few centuries ago, it had one of the highest, probably, although we can't really make a good comparison. It certainly had a very high one. I mean, homicide rates can change. Violence rates can change. The incentive structure striking people of whether it's worthwhile to engage in a dangerous confrontation can change. And the conclusion that Southern culture supports violence and that this is an intractable social problem that cannot be dealt with by economic policy change has crept into a fair bit of literature, and I think it's a grossly premature conclusion. Homicide rates are enormously variable, not just between countries but across years. Here's homicide rates in the U.S. on the basis of vital statistics data over the last century, year by year. And, not only do we have tenfold differences between states at a slice in time, we have tenfold differences between the worst and best years in the 20th century. I mean, these are not small differences. They're immense. There is no good theory about what the hell this is all about, actually. There is no satisfactory account of what this enormous waxing and waning of homicide rates in the U.S. has been about. There are ideas, and they help. And they account for some variability, but we really don't know the explanations. And one reason people have not been terribly impressed with or keen on, or one reason people who don't like the idea of income leveling policies are able to say that, the notion that income inequality is an evil that causes violence, why they're able to dismiss that argument, is because in recent times, homicide rates have been falling in the U.S., and indeed in much of the Western world, but most dramatically in the U.S., while income inequality has been rising. And so the last thing I want to say a few words about is why that might be so, and this gets a bit more speculative. In Canada, the homicide rate has fallen fairly steadily since the 1970s. The trend in income inequality is less consistent. It's up and down from government data. But it certainly was increasing during the 1990s as the homicide rate was continuing down. And that's almost certainly the case in the U.S. as well. Why might that be? That's the question. Well, I think one good candidate answer is demographic shift of a certain sort. Remember who it is who does the killing. It's young guys in competitive contexts. When we do those cross-state analyses of predictors of homicide rate differentials across states, Gini is our best predictor, income inequality is our best predictor, and eats up half the variance. The only other highly significant predictor I can find to add as a second variable in an equation is actually the proportion of the population that consists of young men, age 15 to 34. That's also a very good secondary predictor, accounting for a good hunk of the residual variance. The states that have the most young men as a proportion of their total population have higher homicide rates than the states that have relatively few. That's not too surprising. Well, here's what's happened to that demographic over the last 25 years. As a proportion of the total population in both Canada and the US, 15 to 34-year-old men have gone from being about 18% of the population to being less than 15% of the population. It's not a huge difference. I mean, you know, this is one of those nasty graphs that we always tell our students they should never do. They should be properly zeroed. So I'm cheating and I'm making this more dramatic. I think it's a non-trivial diminution. The economist Stephen Levitt, who many of you probably know as the author of the book Freakonomics, has made a number of arguments about what does and doesn't cause falling homicide rates in the U.S., and he's dismissed demographic change as relatively unimportant, largely on a model in which one assumes that there is an age-specific rate of killing people that, you know, you say, if demographic change were responsible for the change from this time to that, then okay, at this time there were this many 17-year-old men killing each other at such and such a rate. That rate for 17-year-old men will stay the same later, but they're a smaller proportion. If we just, you know, reconstruct that way, then it can only account for about 7% of the decline in homicide during the 90s, according to Levitt. But I think it's a simple argument to expect this to be linear. There's a lot of sociological data indicating that competition within a cohort, within an age cohort, competition for jobs, competition for marriageability, depends a lot on the size of that cohort, and it's not linear. A big baby boom coming sweeping through a population creates very intense competition among those guys, and there's no reason to suppose that when a particular demographic shrinks, that you know, the age-specific rates of killing will nevertheless stay the same. When a particular demographic shrinks, things become less competitive for that demographic. There's less reason for them to feel the need to compete with one another, I would argue. I think Levitt has made an interesting and somewhat persuasive case for the idea that there really has been some lagged effect of the reduced number of unwanted children as a result of access to abortion in the U.S. and perhaps other places. That's a live hypothesis for why there has been a diminution in the homicide rate in the U.S. in the 1990s. I don't know how to operationalize the possibility that improved perceptions of life prospects might be relevant, but there's a lot of cross-national variation in homicide rates that, you know, seems to reflect what you might call, life expectancy, as Margot showed you before, but the life prospects of people, economic uncertainty, predictability of the future. You know, things shot up in the former Soviet republics after the collapse of the Soviet Union, arguably because of both greater income inequality and greater uncertainty about the future. Latin America has big problems in this regard and so on. And maybe perceptions of life prospects have been improving because in some ways life prospects really have been improving. In Canada, at least, life expectancy, remarkably, continues to increase on a more or less almost linear trend without an asymptote in sight, without a clear asymptote in sight. And maybe at some level people, you know, if life expectancy through God knows what mediation impacts people's perception of their prospects, then maybe this sort of thing is relevant as well. And finally, I know this in Canada. I have no idea whether it's true in the U.S. I want to get the data and find out. In Canada, income inequality rose during the 90s, but it turns out that if you partition that into income inequality of among families, income inequality among single women, and income inequality among single men, it rose in those first two categories, and it did not rise among single men. There was no increase in income inequality among single men in the 90s in Canada. So that may be germane as well. Anyway, we've been thinking about things this